the title of the book is The Villains, Rogues, and Heroes Behind New York Place Name. And the biggest of the villains was Richard Riker, who was the city's recorder, which was municipal judge, in the run-up to the Civil War. And Riker's Island bears his name. And where the city jail is, the notorious city jail that's going to be shut down because it is, and this is not my words, but the words of the chief judge, former chief judge of New York, Riker's Island is a stain on the city. It's irredeemable. It must be shut. So anyway, Richard Riker, as municipal judge in the run-up to the Civil War, was tasked with enforcing the Fugitive Slave Acts, which he did happily and willingly. He had personally enslaved at least one person. His family had enslaved dozens. But he also was part of what came to be known as the Kidnapping Club, which was a scheme to not only send people who had liberated themselves from slavery back into slavery in the South, but also to grab random free New York Black people off the street, say that they were fugitive slaves, deny them the right of habeas corpus, and then send them into slavery in the South. And that's like villainy beyond imagination, really, I think.
Everyone, welcome back to Living the Next Chapter. I have someone back on my screen. She was on my podcast in the past, and I'm so excited I get to talk again to Rebecca. We'll be talking about her book. And I love New York City. I have a very special place in my heart for New York. So anytime I get to talk about that and maybe the history, I love history. And today we're going to do all of that in one episode. So I'm in my happy place. Rebecca's here. Welcome to Living the Next Chapter. So glad to have you here. Hi, how are you?
Thanks. I'm so glad to be here. I'm honored to be back. And New York City is the greatest city in the world. I love talking about it. So let's get to it.
Okay. All right. That's good. Let's jump right in. I love it. The city that never sleeps. So let me know, have you been born and raised in New York? Is this your home city? Tell us a little bit about your background.
No, I actually was born and raised in Pennsylvania, which is about 100 miles from New York City.
Yeah.
So I used to come in on the weekends for a big trip to the Museum of Natural History or to the zoo with my parents or to see a Broadway show. And then I moved here as an adult and I've lived here ever since.
So your love affair with New York started very young then?
Yes. Yes, it did.
Nice. Nice. Okay. So you wrote a very interesting book. I know you have a copy of it there with you. Can we see it? And can you tell us what's the name of your book?
I actually don't have the real book with me. I just have my messed up note.
Oh, I love this even better. That's even better.
Yeah. So the book is called Naming Gotham, The Villains, Rogues, and Heroes Behind New York Place Names. And it does have a lovely cover. This just isn't it.
So that's so real to see that with all those scribbles on there and the notes and paperclip together. I love that. That's really cool. What was the origin for the idea behind the book?
So the book was born in traffic. As I mentioned, I grew up in Pennsylvania. My parents still live there. And the only way to get from where I live to in Queens, which is one of the boroughs of New York City, to where my parents live is to drive because there is no public transportation. And it makes me mad every time I have to do it. And the way that you have to drive there is to take the Major Deegan Expressway. That's the highway that goes past Yankee Stadium and it connects to the George Washington Bridge. And anybody who's ever taken the Major Deegan knows that what that means is you're stuck in traffic on the Major Deegan. It's frequently a parking lot. And so we would get stuck and I would curse and I would say, I hate this guy. Who was he? Who is he? And nobody had a clue who Major Deegan was. Everybody takes the Major Deegan if they're driving, but nobody knows who the guy was. So my family got a little sick of hearing me complain. And finally, they said, well, why don't you find out who he was? So I did. And turned out he was a lot less impressive than you might expect, given that this major road is named after him. So that sort of got me interested in, like, how did this happen? How did this guy get a road named after him? And who are all the other roads named after? Who are these people? And that eventually became the book.
Okay, so I got to find out. I know it's a spoiler, but what can you tell us about Major Deegan? Like, what is it about him that ended up with a road named after this person.
Yeah. So William, Major William Francis Deegan is the guy's name. And he actually was a major in the U.S. Army during World War One. But he was a major in the Army Corps of Engineers, and he never left New York. He served the entire war, World War One, here in New York. Like, I always assumed he was somebody who died in battle and leading, you know, charges or something. But he was, after the war, he helped found the American Legion, which is the thing that he's probably most famous for. And then he became a bureaucrat in New York City. He was best friends with the mayor at the time, Mayor Jimmy Walker, who was sort of very flamboyant and an over-the-top character. And then he died young, and he had very powerful friends. So he wound up with a road named after him. Well, there's all kinds of really cool stories about him, but that's the 10,000-foot view.
I love it. Okay, so this being stuck in traffic sparked a search for that information specifically, but then it kind of unfolded for you that you're like, okay, now I'm on to something. I'm going to start pursuing some other things that I'm curious about. Have you always been curious about the naming of places and things and wondering how this came to be, or is it just kind of unfolded from there?
I've always been really curious in knowing the story behind things. So maybe that's the story of how something got named, but it also might be the story of like, how did that get located where it is? Or if it's a road or a civic institution or a neighborhood. I've always been really curious about like, how did we get from to where we are and how far back can we trace that? And, sometimes you can trace it all the way back to the Lenape, the original inhabitants of this land. Sometimes you can only trace it back to maybe the Civil War or to the New Deal or, wherever the historical record sort of peters out.
So this kind of feels like a book that never ends because there are so many stories, so many places in New York. That how do you even finish a book like this? Like there had to be things that you excluded from your writings just to get it within a certain size. So it's not a, 300-pound book. How do you edit this down to, and I'm always curious about what didn't make the book as well, but how do you edit this down to one book?
Yeah, well, this is the first popular press book I've written. And when you write for academic publishers, you tell them it's going to be 80,000 words, and then you give them 140,000 words, and they're like, okay. But it turns out that popular presses don't do that. They tell you it will be 60,000 words, and it will be 60,000 words. So I had to cut out a lot. There are entire chapters that got cut out, some of which I've been blogging about. So if you want to see, say, about who Horace Harding was, there's a road that goes alongside the Long Island Expressway that's named Horace Harding Expressway. Again, everybody takes it. No one has a clue who the guy was. I wrote a blog post about him. I wrote a blog post about Major Deegan and one about Bruckner. The Bruckner Expressway also goes through the Bronx. Because there was stuff I had to cut out of the book, but I had a chapter on Jonas Bronk. I had a chapter on Van Cortlandt. I had a chapter on Frick. Lots of people that I just had to cut because I ran out of room. Jacob Javits, who was a former senator from New York. The Javits Center is named after him. It's a big civic center on the west side of Manhattan, but I just ran out of room.
Hey, so how do we follow along on those blogs then?
They're sort of scattered. There are a whole bunch, but if you search sort of for my name, do a Google search for my name, you'll find them. Or actually, they're all gathered on my website. So my website is just my name, RebeccaBratspies.com. They're all there, collected, the links, you can read them. The nice thing about the blog post is even when the chapter like laid out some of the really fun gossipy stuff about people, the blog post, I had more room to delve more deeply and I could add links. So if you want to like see for yourself the love letters that Gertrude Whitney shared with Esther Hunt, her young love, before her parents quickly married her off to to Whitney, you know, they're in the Library of Congress. You can see them. There's a link in the blog post.
Wow. I love that interactivity. That's great. And the fact that we can pick up some other things that are in addition to the book. Okay, so there had to be something in the process of writing the book where you came across a name or a location or a thing that you found out that was shocking to you, maybe exciting for you, that you're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I found this, or you've solved something that always people were wondering about. Anything that kind of stands out from a reader's perspective, reading the book, that you're excited for them to find out, maybe without giving away everything, but excited for them to find out in the book?
Yeah, there's, you know, the title of the book is The Villains, Rogues, and Heroes Behind New York Place Name. And the biggest of the villains was Richard Riker, who was the city's recorder, which was municipal judge, in the run-up to the Civil War. And Riker's Island bears his name. And where the city jail is, the notorious city jail that's going to be shut down because it is, and this is not my words, but the words of the chief judge, former chief judge of New York, Riker's Island is a stain on the city. It's irredeemable. It must be shut. So anyway, Richard Riker, as municipal judge in the run-up to the Civil War, was tasked with enforcing the Fugitive Slave Acts, which he did happily and willingly. He had personally enslaved at least one person. His family had enslaved dozens. But he also was part of what came to be known as the Kidnapping Club, which was a scheme to not only send people who had liberated themselves from slavery back into slavery in the South, but also to grab random free New York Black people off the street, say that they were fugitive slaves, deny them the right of habeas corpus, and then send them into slavery in the South. And that's like villainy beyond imagination, really, I think. Yeah. And the parallels between Riker's Island as a place now and the conduct of Richard Riker back then really struck me, because I was working on that part just as the lawsuits about the unconstitutional stop and frisk policy in New York, where the New York Police Department was intentionally targeting young Black men, stopping in a year more young Black men than actually exist in the city. So they were multiple stops of people. Terrible. Yeah. And the way that was a tremendous menace to the Black community and largely invisible to the white community really paralleled Richard Riker's life 150 years earlier. He was renowned in the white community. People wrote poems about him. He was a gentleman. He was courtly. He was considered to be like a really nice man, moved in high society. And yet he was this tremendous menace that was preying on the Black community. So anyway, I got a little more serious than I intended to there. But no. For me, that learning that history got me really involved in the move in the campaign to close Rikers, and then in the move for renewable Rikers, which is a plan to convert the island into renewable energy generation after the jail shuts. So, you know, it all reverts back to my environmental justice interests, pretty much everything I do.
It's seasoned in everything that you talk about. And that's what we talked about on Upcycle Canada podcast. Yes. Was that's really who you are and who you want to show up in this world, and your desire for our environment and where we are and better ways that we can live. And I love hearing that in you, and it does, it comes out in everything you say. So I love that, because it's not something you just talk about, is you live this all the time and it shows. That's amazing. I didn't know about Record Island in that way and who it was named after. You just got me. Now I need the book. What else is there? Give us another teaser that can I tease us with maybe something else we're going to find out in the book, that again, if we love New York and we love history, this is the book for us. But is there one more tease you can give us?
Sure. Let me tell you about Adam Clayton Powell Jr. They're one of the avenues that runs through Harlem was renamed after him. He was the first Black man elected to Congress from New York City. He was the second Black man since Reconstruction to be elected to Congress. And he made his name as a civil rights leader in New York City. He was very flashy, and he had trained as a preacher. So he had this incredible speaking style. He was very handsome, very flamboyant. And when he went to Congress, it was before Brown versus Board of Education. It was way before the Civil Rights Act. So Washington, D.C. was segregated. And he would go into restaurants and basically dare them not to serve him. And he'd bring a posse with him. And he was really cool. One of the more racist of the Southern representatives said that, you know, he wouldn't have anything to do with them and he wouldn't sit near him. So Adam Clayton Powell made a point of sitting next to the guy whenever he could. And in fact, one time he followed him around the house a couple times because the guy kept moving his seat and Adam Clayton Powell just kept following him. He was a really colorful character. He also was a tremendously influential lawmaker. So he had a rider that he tried to attach to any funding bill in any committee that he was on. And it was a very simple rider. And it just said that federal funds can't be used for any program that discriminates on the basis of race, national origin, or color. And it was a very quixotic thing when he was doing it. And everybody's like, you know, whatever. But he did it over and over again, became known as the Powell Amendment. And now it is the exact language of Title VI of the Civil Rights Act.
Amazing. Okay. I love that we've talked about Black men being targeted and then the story of a Black man who targeted others and said, I'm going to be here and you're going to have to deal with me. And that's, I love that. That's a great comparison, by the way. Just those two stories you've shared.
You didn't even think of it. Right? As I was
but
sharing those it. With you.
Yeah, but, those are great.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of gossip in the book because I think history should be fun. I think history should be about the foibles of the people as well as about their sort of earth-shattering events. So like you'll hear about Adam Clayton Powell's divorces and, you know, you'll hear about actually Major Deegan had a scandalous divorce. And that was like front page news. Yeah, there's lots of tidbits in there. You can hear about Major Deegan's war on pigeons. He thought they spread polio. They don't.
War on pigeons. There's a book title. I like that. Okay, the other thing I'm always curious about whenever I visit New York, I have friends that lived there for years. They lived in Bushwick. And I just always curious, I don't know if your book covers this or your knowledge goes to cover this as well, but just the boroughs and how everything is named and how everything was established. For somebody on the outside looking into New York going, how did that even happen? Like, is there any knowledge you can give me like around the boroughs and how they were designed and named and all of that? Is there any history there that I can pull from you?
Yeah. So the New York became the city of Greater New York in 1898 when after a referendum in which Brooklyn and Queens voted to join Manhattan and the Bronx. Manhattan had it annexed the Bronx a couple years earlier from Westchester County. The names come from Manhattan, I mean, the original name of the island, we think, was Manhatta. So that's where the name of Manhattan for the island comes from. But Manhattan is New York County, and Brooklyn is Kings County. And so Queens is Queens County, and Staten Island is Richmond County. All of the counties in New York were originally named after English nobility. And like the Sussex County and Dutchess County, and you know, all the counties bear the names of high-ranking British. I guess they're not. I don't know what aristocracy. That's the word I was looking for.
Okay.
Brooklyn is, we think, a corruption of a Dutch word. Not 100% sure. Bronx was the name of a guy, Jonas Bronx, who didn't make it into the book, in part because he wasn't that interesting. I mean, the Bronx is named after him, but he was a Swedish explorer who lived there for a relatively short period of time, but the name just sort of stuck.
Okay. The one thing I saw in a recent news story was there's a little island that's just kind of across from the United Nations. And it's like this own little space. It had something to do with when they were creating the subways or working underground. They had this shaft that became a small little island, and it's now named, but it's like this kind of a, it belonged to the United Nations, but then now it doesn't belong to the United Nations. I don't know if you've heard about this, but it's just this tiny little piece of property right there in the river.
I actually have not, but I really want to find out about it.
There you go. So I don't know the name of it. And somebody's listening, they're like, they're yelling at the speakers right now because they're like, I already know. So, but maybe that's something for an upcoming blog. But there's a story about this piece of property and what to do with it, what has been done with it. And it has, it's had several names in the past. But again, it used to belong.
Not Roosevelt Island. I mean, that's a big island that people
live on. No, it's just tiny, like really, really small. And it just seems to be some sort of connection with what's happening underground. But I would be curious to know more about that. So I'm going to go follow your blog because I'm sure in the future there's going to be a writing about that.
There probably will be.
I'm excited to do that. For the people that are listening that are authors, from your perspective, again, I'm just a big fan of authors. I've never written, but I love listening to authors instruct and teach other authors from what they've learned in the process. There's authors listening and they're on their journey of becoming an author. They're writing or they're ready to publish, whatever. They're looking to you as a published author and wondering if you have any words of wisdom, some advice, things you've learned in the process that maybe could benefit them. Do you have any words of wisdom for the authors listening today?
Yeah, I have a couple of thoughts. First, just write it down. Don't worry about it being good. You can edit bad prose. You can't edit air. And so, you know, don't wait for it to be perfect. Just write it down. And then in the editing process, you can make it beautiful. You can reorganize, you can rewrite, but you can only do that if you've got text to work with. And in terms of one thing that I found, I learned this the hard way a long time ago because I'm a scholar and I write lots of scholarly articles and books, is organization will save you. Have files, folders, have folders for each topic you're writing on and have the most recent version you're writing on, date it. You can have an automatic date update to the folder, to the file name, so that you know which one it is. You don't have the problem of working off of multiple drafts and getting confused. But then also save an earlier draft so that if something goes wrong, you don't lose everything. But everything in between, don't have draft 9.73. You know, just have the draft you're working on and then the earlier draft, an earlier draft, and then put everything else, mark everything else to delete. You don't have to delete it yet, but mark it to delete so that you know that it's not the active version or the safe version. And that will save you so much time in terms of figuring out where you are, because things get lost, things get crossed and confused, especially if you pick up something you haven't worked on in a while, or you pick up a chapter you haven't worked on in a while. And that is my big organization recommendation.
That's very wise words. I like that, because we can do that right now as we're writing. Was there anybody that's inspired you as an author that you look to them and you find some kind of inspiration in how they approach their writing or their writing style, any of that stuff? Is there somebody that you look up to as an author?
Oh, there's so many people I look up to as an author. It's hard to even know where to start. While I was writing my book, a friend of mine was also writing a book. It's called The Octopus in the Parking Garage. A guy named Rob Virchik. It's a book about environmental resilience. And it is such a sophisticated, beautiful weaving together of first-person narrative and, you know, well-documented, well-researched fact. I wish I had that skill that he has. Another really talented writer, Sheila Foster. She's a professor at Georgetown. She writes about cities, which I'm very interested in, and just brings this sort of sweeping gaze that can weave together so many threads at the same time. It's really just a joy to read.
See, that's a selfish question for me, because now I have books to go find as well. You know, because I can kind of unpack a little bit about who you are. I, as a musician, I think I am a blend of everything that inspires me, kind of like a recipe, where I take a little bit from this person, a little bit from that person. This style of music inspires me, that inspires me, and it becomes me. It is a combination of everything. So I think as authors, the more we can draw from other people and people who inspire us, helps to shape our story. I think sometimes in music, some musicians say they're afraid to listen to other music because they don't want to replicate what someone's doing just naturally without thinking about it, and realize that they have a carbon copy of someone else's song. They're like, oh, I didn't realize. I just was inspired by them and it filtered through me. And now I feel like I'm just copying them. But I think the more that we can get inspiration from others instead of writing in a vacuum, I think it just makes our writing better, our music better, whatever we do.
I agree. I mean, I think art should be in dialogue. Literature should be in dialogue. My husband, who's a composer, and I talk about this a lot, about the need to do research and engage with the works of others, because it makes your own work better, but it also makes you part of a wider conversation that is happening in the world through books, through music, through podcasts, where people are connecting ideas that otherwise would be isolated and bringing them together to forge a culture. That's where culture comes from.
So if somebody were to ask you, Rebecca, what is unique about your book in comparison to maybe another book that talks about historical naming and stories behind it, what do you think is your unique special sauce for your book that you're proud to answer that question with?
Well, I think, as I said earlier, I think history should be fun. So my book is very gossipy. I relied tremendously on newspaper articles of the day, and newspapers like the New York Times weren't really the New York Times then. They were more like People magazine, if that still exists. And so you saw the full person in all of their vainglory, you know, their foibles as well as their heroic, more heroic attributes. And I think that is really important. I think that we have, you know, we're having a broader debate in this country about history and what we should be teaching. And I think it's really important that, first of all, we have a version of history where everybody is, that isn't just, you know, sort of bunch of dead white guys, because they're the ones who got to decide what counted as history. And without surprise, they put themselves at the center of the story. But that's only a version of the story. We were all there together making New York City, making the United States, making the world that we live in. And we are all enriched when we have a broader understanding of it. And it should be fun.
So if you had a word of wisdom to someone who is out there in the space, making change, living their life to help others and serve others, if there was any kind of guideline or framework to have something named after us in the future, would you have any kind of words of wisdom for someone to say, this is how I would kind of navigate life to leave an impact that maybe one day someone would name something after you? It's not that we're doing it for that reason, but
yeah,
there's a reason why these people have been named and given this credit for a road or a location, whatever. What kind of person do you think going forward into the future we would need to be to capture the attention and find our plate or name on some location? Any kind of words of thoughts as you kind of review the stories of all these people? Is there like a thread there?
Yeah. Well, in New York City, it helped to be a white bureaucrat who was who was adjacent to Robert Moses. But that's, you know, that's the past. That's how we got a lot of our road names and a lot of our bridge names. But going forward, there's actually this really cool project in Queens called the Queens Naming Project that is collecting the honorary names given to streets and corners in New York City that are really reflective of the communities now. They're very diverse. It's super interesting. And it is people who were local leaders on a very micro and localized scale. The work they did was tremendously important. But they're not necessarily people they're going to have a three-column obituary in the Times. But, you know, most people don't. But they're all people who gave to their community, who saw them their life work as building community and helping other people. And I think that that is an incredible way to be. So I don't know that I have advice for people other than thank you. But I think that one of the things that happens when people are really committed to serving others and building their communities is that they don't talk about the work that they do. And so it goes maybe unseen in a way that it ought not be unseen. So I would say, you know, write about the work that you do, talk about the work that you do. And it doesn't have to be a book. It could be a, you know, an op-ed for the newspaper. It could be a blog post. It could be tweeting even, you know, or whatever we call it now. And, you know, have a presence on social media where you talk about the work that you're doing, because the work's important, and because that way people, first of all, know it's happening and maybe will be inspired to do similar things, but also so that they know who you are.
Yeah. And we live in a global community now where back in the days when many of these locations were named, people's worldview was pretty limited to what they could see and how they could get to. So their world was much smaller,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Even though they maybe traveled the world to get here and move to the United States, their whole view of the world was based on their neighborhoods. Now we have the whole world in front of us, which is amazing.
For good and for ill,
yeah. So you can have a global impact just by how you live your life. Great, great words, yeah. Great words of wisdom. Rebecca, before I have one last question for you before we close off. I know you have a full day today, and I really appreciate your time. Before I go to the last question, though, as far as connecting with you, knowing more about the book, maybe there's questions, maybe there's follow-up, maybe there's someone would like to that has connections with the story you've written about, and they have family members and they'd like to give you more information. They want to reach out to you somehow.
It would be incredible.
Awesome.
I would love
so
that.
How do
and
they
I
do
have
that?
Heard from a couple people. I heard from somebody in the town of Gotham in England, who wrote to me about the sort of the shared name that, you know, Gotham City, which is New York's alter ego, and this town of Gotham have. I love hearing from people. Like I said, my website is my name, RebeccaBratspies.com. You can find me there. You can see all the information there. You can also contact me through the website, or I'm really easy to find online. I'm easy to find on social media. You can find my work email. I would be delighted to hear from people. Oh, on social media, I'm R. Bratspies on pretty much every social media platform that there is. I'm R. Bratspies. So I'm easy to find.
Good. We'll have links to that in the show notes so everyone can connect with you. And I would love for somebody to fill up your inbox with, hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm distant relative of so-and-so. Thank you for your book. Thank you for what you said. Very good. I got a couple more information for you to let you know. That would be wonderful. I would love that email.
That would be amazing.
That would be awesome.
Yeah.
So the name of my show is Living the Next Chapter. So one of my go-to questions that I love to use is, what are you doing right now, Rebecca? How are you living your next chapter? Are there more books in the future, more research? What's coming next for you after this book? Because I know people are going to fall in love with it. And they're going to be like, okay, what do I get more of Rebecca? What's next for you?
Well, my next project is a more scholarly project it's called Global Justice and Environmental Law. So that's perhaps not targeted at the same audience as naming Gotham, but I'm really enjoying thinking about human rights and global justice and how the recently recognized human right to a healthy environment and New York's constitutional right to a healthy environment can help us think about how to do all kinds of things in all kinds of contexts. In terms of New York history, I am always learning more. There'll be a number of blog posts coming in the relatively near future about, in particular, Austin Corbin, who was there was a street named after him in Brooklyn. They changed the name. There's a street named after him in Forest Hills is a neighborhood in Queens. He was a robber baron extraordinaire. And one of the things that he did, among others, was he swindled the Manhasset tribe. No. Can't think of it. The Montaukett tribe, okay, out of about 10,000 acres of land on Long Island that he wanted to use for a port. And the tribe is wound up being derecognized after they lost their land. And the governor of New York just vetoed a bill to re-recognize them as a tribe. So, but I don't think she knows the role that Austin Corbin played in destroying this tribe. So I want to write about that because I want people to know about what a really he's one of the villains, what a villain he is. He also was a raging anti-Semite, and he forbade, I'm telling you some of the things that'll be in the blog post, but he forbade Jews at any of his hotels. He developed Coney Island, and he had a bunch of really fancy hotels there. And George M. Cohan came to his hotel. Not a Jewish guy, but his name was Cohan. George M. Cohan was a famous musician, really famous musician of the era. There's a statue to him in Times Square. And so he came to one of George M. Cohan's hotel. He came to one of Austin Corbin's hotels in Coney Island, and they did their usual, oh, we're sorry, we're full up. We can't accommodate you. And but one of the desk clerks recognized him and then ran to the manager saying, we're turning away George M. Cohan. And so the manager came out and was very smooth and slick and said, oh, there's been a mistake. Of course, we have a suite available and, you know, for you. And George M. Cohan apparently said, well, apparently there's been a number of mistakes. You mistook me for a Jew and I mistook you for a gentleman. And then he left and he never came back.
What a statement.
Yeah.
What a statement. And wow. I can't imagine in our life and time today that that is happening, but it is. And that is sad that we haven't gone past that today where we don't treat people like that properly and each other properly. And I think the more we learn about history, the more we can be better as we go forward.
Yeah. And the cool thing is you see how many people were standing up for what was right throughout history.
Right.
You know, there's this sense of, well, you know, we can't judge people by today's standards. And that has some salience. But you know what? You can judge them by the standards of the people around them who said this is wrong. This is immoral at the time.
And in that, your voice matters and you need to share your voice so that we as a collective can do better because we have multiple voices, different perspectives, and we're doing better for each other. So I think your book is a great step forward in that because now we understand the story behind the name. So Rebecca, it's great to have you on the podcast. Well, and I would love to have you in the future. Please, as you continue to write, I would love to have you come back and get updates and know more about what you're doing in the future. Please come back.
I'd be delighted. Thank you.
Excellent. Everyone, all the information's in the show notes. I'd encourage you to go follow along with the blog. Make it part of your daily reads, your weekly reads, and follow the journey, follow the stories. And the next time you're stuck in traffic and you go, what is the name of this? Why am I on this road? Where did the name come from? If you're in New York, you need to buy the book and you'll know why. B, if you live somewhere else, maybe it's time for you to write a book around where you live. And Rebecca would be a great resource for you to reach out to and how to do that. So
yeah,
Rebecca,
stuck
thank you so
traffic,
much.
Think of me.
There you go. Thank you. Thanks, Rebecca.
Thank you.
Hey, well, thank you for listening. It's a new year, and we're excited to be releasing even more great episodes of Living the Next Chapter, and we want you to come along for the journey. Thank you for being here. If you know of an author that you would love to have featured on the podcast, an author that you enjoy, an author that brings you that excitement, that you would just love to hear them interviewed on this podcast, I would love to hear your suggestion for a future guest and some what would be a question or two that you would want us to ask them on your behalf. Go to livinginthenextchapter.com. There's a little speak pipe icon there. You can leave me a voice message. Tell me who should be on the show and give me some question ideas. And I'll use your request and reach out to that author and invite them on. and give you full credit for the idea. LivingTheNextChapter.com. Would love to hear your suggestion, and thank you for listening. Catch you on the next episode.
Hey there, fellow parent. If you're anything like me, balancing screen time for our kids is a constant struggle. That's why I want to share a little secret with you, KidsPod. It's this amazing app I found that's packed with podcasts just for kids. Imagine stories, learning, and fun, all without the screen. It's been a game changer in our house, keeping my kids engaged and their imaginations running wild. And guess what? It's completely free. So download KidsPod today. Trust me, it's a decision you won't regret.